Hello friends, today I'm going to discuss a very interesting topic which is buzzing around. The name is microservices, right? It is a very hot topic and it is a very popular. Why? Because of its functionality and its scalability. So we will discuss each aspect of this microservices one by one. So let's start without wasting time. Now, to understand microservices, the one thing in your mind coming, why microservices are required? Because we have everything that is required to serve a very good application, very good web application, and we have everything, right? So to understand this, I want to tell you a background detail when we have nothing. Because at the initial time when there is no web application, there is no internet, then what was the thing earlier? Only desktop applications was there initially developed, right? And the thing is, in that web applications there are many features, many code, many things, and those desktop applications are deployed to or individual user machines, right? And time to time the code got bigger and the bigger space was required, and the build whole project, that was a tedious task, and to install that application on individual user machine, it's again very complicated task. So after some time a new evolution came and the internet is there, right? So what was happening at that time? Now we have lots of code, we have lots of resources, those are occupying lots of spaces, right? And we don't want our cost increase, we don't want our architecture increase, we don't want big CPU, big machines at that time. So when internet came to solve that problem, so we can have our application on the single server, right? Because for maintaining the bigger team and the bigger management, bigger code, so we have to spend lots of money, right? Even if you want to scale your application, right, because there are lots of traffic on your application, lots of traffic on your server, then what you will do, you will just scale up that, add more more RAM, you will add that, right? So that thing is very very helpful at that time, but time to time when things grown up, then that formula was not working. Why? Because cost was increasing day by day, and the tons of million and trillion of web services nowadays available. So everyone is using those web services from their own laptop, desktop or application. They don't care behind the scene how many servers are working, how many applications are there, are that load balancer or not. What end user want from the application is he want to talk to your application, that's it. If user will send a request to the server or an application, then he will receive the response back, right? Means that in the moment user raise the request, and he will receive the HTML which will be displayed into the browser. So that is everywhere we can see that response. So now that is called the monolithic architecture, right? Means we have everything, every layer, either it is a customer service, either it is a vendor service, either it is any type of service, either your product belong to any of the domain, everything is on the single server, right? And that is displayed as a single combined application, and many users are accessing them, right? That is called the monolithic architecture. Mono means single, lithic means single stored architecture. Okay, so what happened at the time, if you think about, take example of e-commerce website, right? Because at some time when there is a deal, then there is lots of traffic on your website, right? And you can think about that, and that will be manageable, and sometimes that will be not. And if you want to manage that, then you have to scale your application. But suppose if for the billing area or for the product services, for the special segment, you have the traffic, but when you are scaling that whole application, right, which is not required, but your architecture is built in a way that every part of your application will be scaled up, but actually which is not required. Think about that. If your customer service or the new product launch service is a separate application, and only that area you can scale up from there, that will be really really beneficial for you. Okay, so that's a clue from where the microservice concept is originated, right? Because large server, large application, large code is very hard to maintain, because time to time new team member came up. If you think about the from a team point of view, because a new joiner come up in your team, right? And if he writes some code and he checks in that code, right, on the server, then what will happen? You have to test whole application, not the individual segment, right? So there are several things that we need to take about, and there are several disadvantages in that, like bigger project, and there are so many challenges of testing, right? And the whole testing task take lots of time. So in that way, you can say even the Elasticsearch don't work in a very specific way, because every part of the application is using the elasticity, right? So even the scaling is not worth if we are applying on that monolithic architecture. So to avoid that architecture, right, then the concept that I told you is, if we can think about, if there's a one customer application and one for vendor application, one for new product application, so that will be easily manageable, right, time to time. So let's think about this architecture, yeah, that is specially built for you to understand. So you will have a, you know, this single picture explain everything, right? If we have a single web application, but inside that we have a mini application, or you can say microservices, right? And every service has its own deployed on different servers, right? And those applications are communicating with the server through REST API calls, and servers are communicating with each other. You know, with this architecture might be, you know, in a single way it is very explanatory, but at the end of the scene you will think about, you know, there are lots of questions, means how those services will identify, you know, either whom to talk, when to talk, what is the service name, what will be the configuration, and that the whole thing will be discussed in the microservices architectures architecture point of view. Okay, so I will explain that in my next video, but from this application you will have an idea. Okay, there's a whole web application, but inside that there is an app one that considers it's a customer service. There's an app two, you can consider it's a product service which is displaying all the products, and the app three is a your billing service. So these all three services are individual, deployed on separate server, and all servers are connecting each other if they want to communicate. How? That's the point of discovery, means Microsoft discovery, microservices discovery, right? That we will understand, okay, how can they communicate each other. But every application communicated with its server is through REST API call. That's the need of this actually microservices. And if you will think about in this way, you will understand there are so many things, there are so many advantages of this architecture. Let me show you. There's easy deployment of this architecture. Less money will be spent, because you can scale only the important area, not the whole application. There's a less testing required, because you are making changes in the individual service, right? So think about that. So there is less scaling required, and there's less maintenance cost is required, because there is we know what area we need to scale up, right? This is language independent. Why we are saying language independent? Because it doesn't matter like other REST API is calling, you know, it is a JSON or you know, XML based service, so it can communicate with every, you know, client service, client server architecture. So that's another advantage. So separation of concern is another factor which is achievable through microservices, because every part is you know, separate. There is no mess up, there is no big code, right? And this, and the every service is standalone, independent and single application, right? And that can communicate and serve easily, right? And other part of your application will not be impacted at all. So if you talk about the earlier monolithic architecture and this the microservice architecture, you know, both have its own advantages and disadvantages, right? If you think about the advantages, like if your web application is not of that much bigger, not belong to that e-commerce area, and that is manageable, that is less, there is less number of users are there, is less footprints of your clients. So in that case you can think about that the monolithic architecture, because that has advantage. There is no discovery required, because the application or your service is available on the same server. You don't need to go anywhere, you don't need to do many tedious or complex configurations. But if you talk about the microservices, if you have a bigger application, if you have a large user base, in that case this architecture is very good. Okay, so I hope I have given you a very good idea about what microservices are, and in the upcoming video I will share the microservice architecture. So stay tuned for that. If you have any question, any comment, so please ask. I will revert on that as soon as possible. Thanks for watching this video.